Thank you, Jeffrey, for coming out and sharing part of your story with us. And I know we're all looking forward to hearing it.
Looking forward to what?
Hearing it.
Oh, okay. You welcome.
Yeah. But, yeah, so if you can tell me a little about what you're up to now at Garden Terrace and what your everyday is looking like, what hobbies you enjoy, things like that, whatever you want to share with us about you, what you're doing now.
Oh, okay. Well, first of all, I'm glad to be a resident of Garden Terrace apartment.
Yeah.
And I've been here since 2009. And caseworker helped me get here. And I'm glad to be here. And I'm on my feet now, you know, financially stable, and able to just enjoy freedom.
Yeah.
And as you know, and a lot of people know, I was incarcerated for 32 straight years from a young age at 19, and got out at 51. And I've been free 9 years as of March the 10th.
Yeah.
So I'm glad about that. And some of my hobbies I like, lip syncing songs and putting them on YouTube. And I believe the background is that, of that is in prison, that was one of my hobbies. I like dancing and listening to the music a lot, you know. And I tried many times to get a GED,
yeah,
and the math was so hard, you know. Every time it got hard, I just quit and got out of school. But I know we don't supposed to have that quitting mentality. But continuing to show interest in math and learning enough to acquire the GED, I got like riding my bicycle and I'm enjoying freedom,
yeah,
and I like being free, and because formerly in my life I was incarcerated a lot, even from 9 years of age, and even including prison the first time. So I just miss freedom a lot, and now I really value it. Okay, you can go to the next question. I'm trying to squeeze out a good adequate answer your question on what you're up to, hobbies, and so forth. I'm trying to enjoy life, you know?
Yeah, speak from the heart.
Yeah.
But I know you like to write poetry. If you can speak a little about that. I know you just copyrighted your book and you just been doing it. When did this passion come about and what are you doing with it?
Okay, I like writing poems and books. Nothing I've written is published. It's just copyrighted in the copyright office, and I'm working now on what I just copyrighted, a book called Pictures with Comets and Poems.
Yeah.
And it's something easy to write. I'm not saying I'm a great writer, but it's something easy to write, and I basically showed interest in writing poems when I was in prison the first time in 1974 for destroyed state property.
Yeah.
I flooded a jail, you know, in Gatesville. Because I was in there 4 or 5 months, they wouldn't let me know what they were gonna do with me. So I got, you know, bored and kicked off the water faucet. But I didn't know the sheriff lived downstairs. Messed up a lot of his property, so they gave me a 3-year sentence. Actually, 2/14/74, a car took me to prison. That was Valentine's Day.
Yeah.
That was a bad, bad Valentine's gift. But anyway, when I was in prison, a teacher that introduced herself to students, I don't remember nothing else she said. I like my students to bring poetry. I was about 18 and 19.
Yeah.
And never wrote a poem in my life. just to do what she said, start writing poems.
Yeah.
I don't have any little poems, but it was a stack.
Yeah.
About trees, about this, about that, anything that comes to mind. So I don't recall no response. But down through the years, that has taken off. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot of times my writing have become dormant, but at times it's resurged throughout all the years since 1974. But around 1980, when I was in prison the second time, I keep looking at that, get a facial in it. Around 1980, I was listening to Stories of Great Christians, and it came on a Christian station in Houston, KHCB-FM, 105.7, I think it was. And the story of John Bunyan came on, who wrote the classic, The Pilgrim's Progress.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a journey from, it's an allegory of the journey from this world to the next world. It's a written poem, a written story in allegorical form of the Christian journey. But it has a lot of characters on this road traveling to the celestial, I lift that word up, it means heavenly, city.
Yeah.
And in all these different characters, Christian is the main character. Mm-hmm. Later he gets a companion name of Faithful.
Yeah.
And they meet all these different characters with different names like Talkative, and Hypocrisy, and Formalist, and Mr. Buy-ins, and all these characters thinking they're on the road, they want to end up in heaven, but they don't want to sacrifice. They don't want to come in at the beginning of the road, which represents repentance.
Yeah.
The book is highly symbolic. A lot of people don't understand it, and from time to time, I explain it to people what Bunyan is means and how you, what he means for today in real life. So, and I got a long poem, a treatise to that book, and that I share from time to time on Facebook, so I can expose people to the greatness of the book. It's my favorite book on this planet. So he inspired me so much, I wanted to be a writer.
Yeah.
A writer. I wanted to write like him so much. A friend named James Lott in prison around 1980-81-82. I sent him a manuscript I wrote, just handwritten stuff. And said, what you think about this? I probably said, you think it's like John Bunyan? He sent me a note, sent me my manuscript back, and sent with a note saying, you are not John Bunyan. You are Jeffrey Holly. If you tried to be John Bunyan, there would be nobody left to be you. I've always remembered that. So even though I write, I basically keep it in my own style and look at myself as being influenced by him, because I can't be him, you know? So to wrap this up, that's a long answer to your question. I'm too long-winded to wrap this up. Photos with Comments is just simple book. Every chapter is named the same. The continuation of this book till you get to the last chapter, and it's just photo collages where I get an idea and give a topic and comments, and bam, that's throughout the chapters, and the chapters are interspersed with poems.
Yeah.
Poems I feel are really good, really express some deep emotion. Okay, next question.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be that long-winded.
Your own reading that poem and things like that. I was saying after the road that you took and being in jail for 30 years, what lessons can you give to people who were prisoners, who are prisoners, or you know, thinking about committing a crime or things like that, because you've come a long way and are an exceptional person. So if there's anything that you can credit to or give thanks to, kind of thing.
Okay. I'm going to try to answer every aspect of your question. or sometimes I'm looking at ESPN and a sports figure has asked a question in an interview, and it may be a two-part, and it may be a three-part.
Yeah.
Sometimes they do good, but I listen, I said, they didn't specifically address that particular question. So, okay, but anyway, I should be belittling them because they do pretty good. Okay, but anyway, advice I can give.
Basically, just kind of like, how'd you get in there for 30 years? And to sum it up, how'd you get in there for 30 years? And what are you doing now to prove to yourself and others that, you know, whatever I did was a mistake, but now I'm this new Jeffrey Holly. And so, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, how did I get in there? I listened to somebody who influenced me to help Robert Person. And, you know, and I did inflict harm, but the person recuperated in the hospital, so I'm very glad of that. You know, and this wasn't planned, and, you know, I'm just walking the streets, and this person talked to me, and I made a U-turn, and we ended up getting caught, I think a few weeks later. And so I listened to wrong advice. So my advice to other people is not to let anybody influence you to do wrong. Every now and then, when I'm dancing or out in public, you know, to my music, because I dance just about anywhere, in comments about the songs and tell them to look at me on YouTube and so forth, I interject and stay out of trouble, you know? So, the reason I stayed so long is that I was kind of getting in trouble inside the prison. So, and that kept me longer. And what I've learned and taken away from being in prison is that it's not a place to be, you know. It's better being out here. In fact, it is unnatural to be incarcerated because people are made for society to function and be productive citizens. The poem I share has this on the end of this thought. Prisons are part of government punishment for wrongdoing. You know? So, as a protector of society, you know? So, the Bible even talks about that in 1 Peter, I believe, chapter 4. And chapter 2, I believe. Okay, so that's my takeaway. That's what I've learned, that I don't want to go back, and I'm enjoying freedom more and more.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna say this while I'm on this subject. At the age of 9, I first started getting incarcerated.
Okay. One second, let me.
Is it still recording?
Sorry.
If it don't work out, mine is recording. Let me see if mine's still recording. Yep, we're still recording. I think I got a lot of room in that SD card, so.
Yeah.
What's going on right there?
Let's see. Yeah, so if, just repeat the, if you want to repeat that, I don't think you got it. The advice that you would give after what happened, if you can talk about what happened again, and the advice you would give.
Okay. I don't know how far to back up because I don't know where the problem started.
Just like that last question.
Okay, so my advice to people that are young and impressionable is to just not let anybody influence you for evil, wrong. Because as I said, I was just walking the street at 19, and this person influenced me to commit a robbery. You know? So I did inflict harm on the person. The person got well in the hospital, and I'm glad of that. I was very glad of that. Because when I got in prison, I was exposed to reading the Bible, and it talks about wrong in life and consequences and how it discourages us from wrong. And I was so engrossed in the Bible around 1977, 78 in prison. And they nicknamed me Preacher. I used to, you know, take my Bible to work, preach the inmates, you know. And I'm a literal person, detailed person as a writer. So, and it said, do something, I did. Go you into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's King James. Creature just means person. Yeah. Okay. Everybody gonna listen to them. Hey man, you believe in God? Hey man. But anyway, but I did drift from God around 1980, 81, and just started idolizing secular music. I used to listen to nothing but Christian music, you know. But throughout 32 years in prison, I was going back and forth with God, back and forth to what I felt brought fun, you know. And a lot of times, attitudes with me and people initiate fights, you know, with me, you know. And that's helped me stay in a long time because they have a disciplinary side of prison. They keep up with your racket. And when the parole board interview you, for possible parole, which occurred 5 or 6 times with me, and most of the time they put me off for my salty behavior, which was the reason, you know, because I wasn't showing signs of changing. But the last 6, 7 years before I got out, I said, wait a minute, I'm going to slow down. You know, if somebody else wants to initiate something, try to get away from it, you know. So that's, you know, on a 99-year sentence, it don't take 32 years to get out of it, you know. I came up for parole consideration, I think, by 12 years, but I was getting in trouble. Okay, my takeaway is that I want to stay free, you know, and I'm enjoying freedom. And freedom is better than being incarcerated. And being incarcerated is unnatural. And it's punishment for crime. And part of government is to punish crime, you know? And that aspect of government is prisons, you know? And prisons are a deterrent to crime. And the highest form of punishment, capital punishment, is for somebody who go take somebody's life out of malice. Mass murders and so forth. So therefore, government has the power to execute those people, even though it's a lot of people. There are varying opinions whether they should have capital punishment or not. They had that in the Bible, you know what I'm saying? But the reason is because God values life, considered it sacred. And for somebody to go presumptuously take it, you know, it was a that's the government punishment, capital punishment. And I'm glad that the person didn't die that, you know, home, but recuperated fully. All right, I think I recapped what was possibly missed, and it's gonna be doubling on that, double on that. Okay, you
Yeah, if you wanna talk a little. My last question, or one of the last ones, is just to talk a little about your kind of career plans and goals moving forward after being out 9 years now and living this freedom. What are you doing now? What are you preparing for in the future? What are you looking forward to, kind of thing?
My goals is to be a better writer. My goal is to get a GED. Like I was in school 3 years, and all of my assessment score placement scores was at 5.3, 5.2, four something even, for 3 years. And it seemed like I'm just bumping my head up against the wall. I was trying, writing all kinds of notes to the point where tutors and teachers said, you write too many notes. As soon as they told time, I'm writing notes. Because I don't recall the third, fourth, fifth, sixth grade where the foundation of math is accomplished. I don't recall the first 7 years of my life. So somewhere in my life, that gradual buildup to understand, grasp GED type math, I missed. And I'm like stuck. And when I took the GED first time in prison, I'm 60, and in 1988, I was like in my 20s, I believe. Let me see, 88, 1990. Oh, anyway, but I was young like you. So I did the whole GED test and guessed all of the math because I didn't know how to work. But I know how to better work than now. Now, being in school is on hold now. But out of school, I still want to, some kind of way online or some kind of way, grasp that GED type math, get that GED. Okay, now, next. Discard Terry's is efficiency. Discard Terry's, that is an efficiency apartment. Is just for purposes of people that want to be established better in life, and it's integral, you know, it's an integral part of moving on to something bigger and better. But I've been here 6 years, and I like it. I'm satisfied with being here really forever. But I would like to have a house, or maybe an apartment with rooms. So that's a possibility. But being here forever is okay too. So that's an up for grab situation. Okay, I want to be a better writer. I want to possibly move to a bigger, more spacious apartment or house. And what else? I want to continue to lip sync videos on YouTube. You know what I'm saying? What else? See, I need to really sit down and think hard of goals so I can write them down. That's why I write stuff all the time, you know? Because it's hard for me to walk around. Everything is on my mind to do, you know? But I write notes all the time. Notes out on my wall remind me of apartment, remind me of technology so I don't forget. Once I learn, I don't need to know no more. So I write notes about just everything. Notes that come to me for possible form so I don't forget. It seems like I'm already writing. I used to keep up with my whereabouts, and I recently stopped doing that because I was I listened to Investigates Discovery. When I used to look at Investigates Discovery, which is a show of crimes that have been resolved. When the crime is fresh, investigators ask, where were you at such and such a day? And I said, I'm gonna start doing that because what if somebody framed me? All the years I done, I might not remember. When I used to see the dietitian, I don't see her no more because I graduated from that, you know, my weight was maintained and so forth. She used to ask what you ate this morning, what you ate yesterday. And I said, from now on, still straining my mind to remember just that. I'm right. Just constantly write. So, you know, the fact that I feel like I can be a good book writer, you don't need math to do that. You may need math is observable counting.
Yeah.
If you get to be a good author and you sell millions of books, I might need some math to, you know, but hopefully I have a good accountant and know math more by then.
Yeah.
So a guy told me in prison when I was in that 28 years, when he learned I didn't have a GED,
you ain't got a GED. You been here 28 years, you post out a PhD.
I was embarrassed, you know? So I said, just because my defense was just because somebody been somewhere a certain time don't mean they supposed to be something. That was like a defense mechanism, but he had a point. But I did squander a lot of time dancing, put a lot of energy in dancing. But every day, I was in school 5 or 6 times, maybe more. In and out, it got too hard, in and out. You know what I'm saying? So. But anyway, that's part of my goal, just to get that GD, because I like rings, as you can see, silver rings. Not real expensive, but you know, and one day I plan to get a GD and get that ring, get the GD ring made, because I do feel incomplete, you know. But I believe writing is a trait, you know, it can be developed, you know. And I ain't saying I'm all the way, you know, established and know-it-all writer, but it can be. I make mistakes all the time. You know, a lot of the books I send to the copyright office, I end up still doing minor editing, you know. But minor editing and so forth is a lot under the same copyright fee, as long as you don't do too much. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay,
you can ask another question.
If there's anything, I'm kind of wrapped up with the question.
Oh, okay.
If there's anything you want to share.
Yeah. To wrap it up.
Yeah, if you want to say anything, if you want to, if you have anything out of your story that I didn't ask or you want to share.
Okay. Let me see, here, the other day when we was preparing for this, here's some questions. Let me see, what are you up to? You got that? And I wrote it down, see? I love writing things. Did you always like writing poetry? No, but I alluded to that, and that lady, that school teacher, and when I was like 1974, 75, said she liked students to bring poetry. I didn't know I could even write nothing like that, you know. I guess it was innate. That one of the words I looked up in the dictionary in prison. I looked up a lot of words in prison, you know, and I just underlined them when I read books, so that's why I know. Okay. Here's one. Let's see if you got this one. Do you want to talk about life before prison? How I got there, I touched on that, right? And life before prison, I can put add a little bit to that. I said, life before prison, I don't remember the first 7 years, and I don't remember much, you know. I don't even remember knowing a grandfather. I don't remember playing like kids. I saw a picture one time a relative sent me, an older sister sent me, I believe, when I'm on the ground, just sitting down with two other sisters that was older, looking at the ground. I was probably 3 or 4 in that picture. I don't remember that at all. So, I don't remember no Christmas parties, no birthdays at home, none of that, you know. My memory, unfortunately, picked up at 9, some negative institution, you know. Though I'm not glorifying an incarcerated state, it appears that which is negative are early things I remember the most. But I don't try to remember negative things, dwell on them, you know. They just come up every now and then in conversation in the way of, in the sense of I'm thankful now. I appreciate freedom more. And sometimes I use as illustrations to convey a point. Okay. I'm on my last part, so I would have hell yeah. This reminds me of one time somebody was recording me on a video playing basketball, and is it still recording? I kept asking. The guys kept on saying, yep. Oh, by the way, Shady and I played basketball since he's been there, and Shady is a
Summer Service
Learning Program Intern from UT.
Notre
mean, you're Notre Dame. So I'm thinking he's from UT. So, and he's here to just do those type of things.